Well, hello to all of you. Thank you so much for joining us today. It's a real pleasure and privilege to be able to pray with you. We're going to use the Taste of God liturgy, which you're willing to use yourselves, or you can just sit back and listen to the prayers. We'll do our reading partway through, and please feel free to comment at any point, but especially after the readings when we have our what would be our discussion. And when it comes to our time of prayer, if people would like to put prayers up in the comment box, that would be great. I'm actually going to hold a period of silence for the prayers, but anything that comes up in the comment box will be prayed for. So yes, please feel free to use that and welcome. So we'll have a moment of silence before we begin. O God, make speed to save us. O Lord, make haste to help us. O taste and see that the Lord is good. Happy are those who take refuge in him. Bless the Lord, all you works of the Lord. Sing praise to him and highly exalt him forever. Let the earth bless the Lord. Let it sing praise to him and highly exalt him forever. Bless the Lord, all that grows in the ground. Sing praise to him and highly exalt him forever. Bless the Lord, you springs. Sing praise to him and highly exalt him forever. Bless the Lord, all people on earth. Sing praise to him and highly exalt him forever. Bless the Lord, you servants of the Lord. Sing praise to him and highly exalt him forever. Bless the Lord, spirits and souls of the righteous. Sing praise to him and highly exalt him forever. Bless the Lord, you who are holy and humble in heart. Sing praise to him and highly exalt him forever. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. One does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. So, our reading today is taken from the Gospel according to St. Luke, chapter 14, verses 7 to 11. Now, it's quite a short reading, this parable, so I will read it once. We'll have a pause. Then I will read a psalm. And then we will have the reading from the Gospel again, and then a brief reflection. So, the Gospel according to St. Luke, chapter 14, verses 7 to 11. When Jesus noticed how the guests at the dinner chose the places of honor, he told them a parable. When you are invited by someone to a wedding banquet, do not sit down at the place of honor, in case someone more distinguished than you has been invited by your host. And the host who invited both of you may come and say to you, "Give this person your place." And then in disgrace, you would start to take the lowest place. But when you are invited, go and sit down at the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he may say to you, "Friend, move up higher. Then you will be honoured in the presence of all who sit at the table with you. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. Psalm 131. O Lord, my heart is not lifted up, my eyes are not raised too high. I do not occupy myself with things too great and too marvellous for me. But I have calmed and quieted my soul, like a weaned child with its mother. My soul is like the weaned child that is with me. O Israel, hope in the Lord from this time on and forevermore. Our reading from Luke's Gospel once again. When Jesus noticed how the guests at the dinner chose the places of honour, he told them a parable. When you are invited by someone to a wedding banquet, do not sit down at the place of honour, in case someone more distinguished than you has been invited by your host. And the host who invited both of you may come and say to you, give this person your place. And then in disgrace, you would start to take the lowest place. But when you are invited, go and sit down at the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he may say to you, friend, move up higher. Then you will be honoured in the presence of all who sit at the table with you. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. So, it will be interesting to know what people felt about this parable. Please feel free to comment. I have some reflections myself. I think that it is a parable about humility, but I think it's easy to perhaps understand it as a parable which encourages to put ourselves down, to a parable about ostentatious humility. But I don't think that is the case. I agree with David. On first reading, it can sound like a parable about false humility, but I don't think that's what it's about. It's not about false modesty, false humility. It's not about being humbler than thou, like Uriah Heep, ever so humble. Because actually, that kind of ostentatious humility is a thinking about oneself and about how others perceive oneself, and that's not what I think this parable is about. After all, Jesus says, when you fast, don't disfigure your face like the hypocrites. When you fast, anoint yourself with oil. I don't think it's about that kind of humility. I think actually it's about thinking of others before ourselves. It's an encouragement to perceive the qualities and gifts of others and to think about these things first, before thinking about ourselves as proud or humble. It's an encouragement for me to see others as God sees us. Yes, as Dave says, there's a place at the table for everyone, including people with overlarge egos. That's absolutely true. Hannah says, it's interesting to see how it reflects a hierarchical understanding of society, but it doesn't feel like it's telling us to put ourselves below everyone, but telling us to start in the lowest seat on an equal footing. Yeah, I think that's right, actually. I think that is what it's saying, that actually God loves us all, and it's an encouragement for us to look on others with that same love, to think about others, not ourselves, not to think about our own pride or humility, but to think of others first, and then ourselves, to see others as God sees us. Yvonne says, for some of us, there doesn't seem to be a place at God's table, whatever we do. I don't think that's true. However, I do believe that that's how some people feel, absolutely, and we will hold that in our prayers, in our time of prayer. Ella says, there is a struggle to get past the structure of hierarchy before we can get to that message. I think that's true as well, actually, but I think that's true of so many of the parables. I think the parables force us to think. They force us to ask difficult questions. They put us in awkward places. That's one of the things that I think is so actually wonderful about Jesus's teaching in parables, is that actually where we position ourselves is not always obvious. It makes us, in the language of the Great Commandment, love God with all our mind. It stretches our minds and asks us questions about how we perceive ourselves, others, the world, and our place within that. Eudoxia, interesting to note that the end still presumably requires someone else to be moved down. That's interesting, actually. I think that's right. I think that's right. But actually, if we're thinking about others, that's in some ways not a problem. We don't have to assume that people would be bothered about being moved down. Actually, if everyone has a place at the table, at God's table, then everyone has a place. Bye, Kath. Thanks very much for joining us. Kath has to go. Yvonne says, it's difficult to see ourselves as God sees us in the face of so much that seeks to deny us of his love. I think that's a painful truth. I think that so much in the world behaves in a way that is counter to that. But again, I think that's another powerful thing about this parable, that actually it's encouraging us to not behave as the world does encourage us to. Our society, our culture encourages us to seek the highest place, to want to be first, to want to be the best, to see other people as obstacles or enemies, or as somehow thwarting our ambition. Actually, that's the world. That's not how God sees us. And it's not how God wants us to see each other, I don't think. Ginny says, parables usually speak of an inner world where the Lord is Christ within us and other characters represent aspects of our ego. So here it's not letting the ego take the highest place at the table, but inviting it to be smaller, humbler, while we wait for the Christ within to arise. Then the ego knows its proper place, becomes part of the bigger picture. That's really beautiful. That's a really beautiful reading, I think. Yvonne asked a question about identity and where identity lies in this. I think that's a very good question. I think that, again, the world encourages us to see our identity in worldly terms. I think, actually, what this scripture, what God calls us to, is to see that our identity isn't really within our control, and our true identity is, as St. Paul says, is hidden with Christ in God. And Jesus invites us to the table. I think that's right, Richard. Well, I'm going to wind our discussion up now, but thank you so much for the comments. That was really brilliant. I enjoyed that very much. So we'll move now to some moments of silent prayer. And please feel free to add intercessions, things you'd like to pray about, like others to pray about, to the comments box, and we will hold all those in some moments of silence. So let us pray. Thank you all so much for those prayers. And I think we can all pray in confidence that we pray to God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden. God hears us all when we pray. And so we draw our prayers together in the Collect for Palm Sunday. Almighty and everlasting God, who in your tender love towards the human race sent your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ, to take upon him our flesh and to suffer death upon the cross, grant that we may follow the example of his patience and humility, and also be made partakers of his resurrection, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And going back to our Taste of God liturgy, we'll pray together the prayer of Alcuin of York. Eternal light, shine into our hearts. Eternal goodness, deliver us from evil. Eternal power, be our support. Eternal wisdom, scatter the darkness of our ignorance. Eternal pity, have mercy upon us, that with all our heart and mind and soul and strength, we may seek your face and be brought by your infinite mercy to your holy presence. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And we conclude by praying together. God, be in my head and in my understanding. God, be in my eyes and in my looking. God, be in my mouth and in my speaking. God, be in my heart and in my thinking. God, be at mine end and at my departing. Amen. The Lord bless us and keep us. The Lord make his face shine upon us and be gracious to us. The Lord lift up his countenance upon us and give us peace. Amen. Thank you for joining us today. It's been a real pleasure and privilege to pray with you, and I look forward to joining you all next week.